all, thank you very much for doing this. I really appreciate it. It's an honor. And I hope what I can do is ask you about your touch upon some of the important moments in your life and your career, not just the latest film, because I know that's what you're being honored for the whole career this week in Hollywood.
他说他想那个不光问你一些关于九四二的事儿，然后关于您整个这个就是从业以来的这些一些都想了解一下。And
to begin with, did you watch a lot of movies as a kid? And if you did, were there any films or filmmakers that were particular favorites or influences for you?
嗯，说您从小是就开始看电影吗？有没有什么比较喜欢的演员啊、电影啊或者导演，就哪个类型的片子？
我们小的时候看的更多的是苏联电影，嗯，然后还有就是国产的那些革命的电影啊。He
said when they were younger in their generation, it's usually they are more exposed to Russian films and the domestic revolutionary themed films.
然后到了这个，其实真正开始能看到一些好的电影，其实是二十多岁以后。二十多岁，so.
After his 20s is when he's more exposed to foreign films.
And when did you first have the opportunity to try filmmaking yourself, even if it was just something for fun, messing around? How did that first opportunity come about?
说您就是第一次拍电影是个什么样的契机，是您就第一次经历，不一定是。
有作品，但是就是拿起了摄影机开始想做这件事情，是小的时候吗？还是？不是，我原来是做舞台美术的，画画的。我其实，在做导演之前，我做了几部电影的美术。然后，因为做美术的原因，我开始对导演的这个事儿非常感兴趣啊，因为你可以讲你自己要讲的故事。
He said he began his career as an art director and on stage, both on stage and in films. And that's when he started to look at what the director is able to do. Like, they can tell stories, they can create their own work. And that's when he felt like, okay, I want to try that too.
And I know that that was a very formative time for you, the time working as a scenic painter. And how did that lead to television? Because I know that unlike most filmmakers in China, you started in television first. So how did that lead to television?
他说跟您同时代的很少出现直接从舞台美术直接您先拍了电视剧才去拍电影，说怎么从舞台美术就转换到电视剧？
就是其实是那样，就是。 当我对电影感兴趣的时候，是中国电影最糟糕的时候，就整个的那个电影市场全垮了，观众因为电视剧的出现，大家都习惯在家里看电视，那个时候刚好我在一个电视剧制作的公司，就是北京电视台的，所以我就在那儿做美术，然后我开始自然而然，因为我们那个单位就是拍电视剧的。 但是因为，我为什么能拍电影？是因为那个电影已经不像过去，还有很高的一个门槛。那个时候，所有拍电影的人都去电视台，都去拍电视剧，人都跑到那儿去了，没有人来拍电影。所以我因为我拍的电视剧收视率都非常高。我觉得这个观众应该是一样的哈，就是既然他能喜欢我拍的电视剧，他一定也可以喜欢我拍的电影。 所以我带着这些观众的基础来拍电影，所以我第一部电影拍完了就观众就很。这个大概是哪年？在九七年。
He said, basically it's all about the timing. At the end of the 1990s in China, actually the film market basically it's really doomed. It's completely crashed. No one's watching. No one's going to the movies because everyone's at home watching TV dramas. That's when the Chinese TV drama market peaked. And he was working at the Beijing television station by that time as an art person, scenic director. And he felt like, okay, since no one's making films right now, let's start with the TV dramas. And then once once he's able to build a really strong audience base, and then he will take that group of audience, his fans, to the movies. And then what happens is, because the movie market's so bad, it's really easy to get into the market. This threshold is not that high.
Mm-hmm.
So he felt like, okay, he had good practice at the TV dramas, and then now he can move to the big screen.
Smart strategy. From the very beginning of your career, if my information is correct, you never used government funding on your films. You always privately financed them. Was that out of what was the motivation for that decision?
因为那个时候政府也不投资，没有人来投资。我第一次拍电影，那个投资人就问我，你可以不可以不拿片酬？如果这电影不卖钱，你就等于白干；如果要是卖钱了，你就会比你应该拿的片酬要多，按照那个票房来分给你。我就是在这样的一个新的这样的一种制片的体制下。
He said it's actually very interesting. Back in that time, because the market is so bad, the government wasn't funding at
all. Really?
It wasn't even a choice. And then his first producer asked him, okay, so I'll fund your film, but you're not going to get paid at all until I get revenue. And then we'll talk numbers based on how much money we made from box office. He said he's one of those directors who emerged from that little awkward system that China had during that time.
Interesting.
在那个之前呢，就是中国呢就没有私人投资拍电影，全是国营的电影厂。一个导演从电影学院毕业，分到一个国营的电影厂里头，那时候大概有五六家比较大的电影厂，studio，等于你分到那儿。 国家投资，你拍，你赔赚跟你没关系。就从我们开始拍电影那时候，不是这样，改变了。
He said before his generation, it's once you graduate, once a director graduates from the film academy, he or she is sent to one of the 5 or 6 big movie studios, government-funded studios in China, and then basically you just work for them based on a salary. It doesn't concern you at all, like how much your film makes and whatever, like what piece you do is all made. The decision is all made for you.
But I'm sorry.
而且那个你必须是学电影学院毕业的，然后分到这儿，你从场记副导演开始做起，然后联合导演。所以第一，你不是电影学院毕业的，你是不可能到电影厂当一个导演。 第二个就是，如果你是电影学院毕业的，你也需要大概经过10年的时间，你才有可能有机会做导演。但是，就从我们那个时候，因为电影垮掉了，所以也没有人设置这个门了。所以我才有机会。我没有学过电影。
Before his time, he said, it's a very strict order. There's a very strict order to becoming a director. You have to graduate from the Beijing Film Academy, like majoring in directing, and then you go to the film studio, and then you start as a script supervisor, and then you work your way up until, he said, a lot of people, not for at least 10 years, you can have your own piece.
Huh.
Yeah, but that's before his times. During his times, because the market is so bad, no one cares anymore. There's no standard. Yeah.
In some films, particularly early in your career, I know you also acted in your films, mm-hmm. or acted in films, and I wonder, do you enjoy acting, and do you feel that having acted yourself makes you a better director?
他说他知道您在早期的作品里面都有参加演出，您是喜欢演出呢，还是您觉得演戏会帮助您导戏？
一开始觉得好玩
just for fun in the beginning.
但是后来我觉得这个不行，那个我只能顾把一个工作做好、
嗯、
而且我觉得演戏是需要接受专业的训练的、
嗯、
我演戏的时候还是会我不引招演戏的时候我还是愿意做导演。
He said before it's just purely he was curious, he thought it was fun, he tried it, but then he later found out that he can't really concentrate as being the actor and the director, and then he believes that as an actor you do need professional training, yeah, so it's not that enjoyable after
that. Yes. for Americans who may not know, are you able to explain what the genre Hesui Pian is, because I believe that it was your film, The Dream Factory, that really ushered in was really the first example of that. And so but it's a genre that Americans, or a concept that Americans may not understand.
That's true. 他说对于美国观众来说，您创造了一个新的，就是美国人从来没有听说过的类型片，就是贺岁片。就您会怎么解释这个类型片给一个完全不知道这是怎么回事的美国人听？
啊，其实美国有，它就是为圣诞节定制的那些电影。中国啊，一开始就是，不管是拍电影的导演，还是写电影评论的影评人，所有的他们都是只认为电影应该拍文艺片，拍艺术片。对商业片，香港的、好莱坞的，都是非常排斥的，认为这就不是电影。但是我觉得，对当时的中国电影来说，最重要的其实是把观众拉回到电影院里头来。所以我一入手，我也是我被这个环境逼的，我必须要拍那个观众喜欢的电影。我不能考虑只是表达我自己的东西。因此我就把这个，我觉得过年的时候可能大家需要一些喜剧。我觉得这样的话是这个电影的投资能够回收回来。同时我自己也觉得拍喜剧特别好玩，所以我就从喜剧入手，我们说叫贺岁，就专门为过年定制，为一个档期定制这样的一部电影。
He said, first of all, back in his times, most directors believe that film is supposed to be art house. It's not supposed to appeal to everyone, and it's not supposed to be something that everyone can enjoy. It should be a higher standard to be a film director. But then he believes, because the market was so bad, he said the first step should be getting the audience back in the, in the movie, the film theaters in the first place. He said he has a guarantee that the funders get their funding back, and then people actually start to enjoy watching movies again. And then he felt like he was, a comedy was one of his strong suits. He enjoys making comedy, and he believes that there's that genre in America as well. He said every Christmas you see a lot of happy films, family-oriented films, and he just wanted to, at the end of the year, he just wanted to give it a really happy ending to everyone. And then that had a really good outcome. People really enjoyed that.
我刚开始拍电影的时候，第一部电影卖300多万美元的票房，在整个中国大陆的市场上，当时就是票房的第一名。到今天，中国的票房的第一名已经达到了1.5亿美元。就是说这个。我觉得我对中国电影最大的一个贡献，就是因为我开始拍那种电影，观众开始对电影有兴趣，然后经过这个将近15-16年的努力，使中国的电影彻底走向了市场。我觉得我在这里起到作用是最大的，让观众重新回来，使这个市场每年就是像那个爆米花一样的这个爆发的票房。
您那个300万美元那个是甲方
乙方。
that he started, to the one that really boomed the film was Dream Factory, right? And then that made him $3 million US dollars in China, and that was just unheard of.
Mm-hmm.
And then starting from that, he said right now the record in China is $150 million in China. And then he felt like he played a really important role in the whole booming of the Chinese movie industry.
And so just to clarify though, what it means to be a Hesuipion film is that you come out between, is it roughly Christmas and the Lunar New Year?
Mm.
And all of those films that would be labeled that come out during that period and are basically commercially appealing movies?
Mm. 他说他就想再明确一下这个贺岁片，是说从
圣诞节那个期间到中国新年这一段时间出来，只要是商业片都可以称为贺岁片吗？对，最早呢，就是其实就是从圣诞节到元旦，这几天，而且呢，一定是喜剧，可是我每年这么拍，观众就这个时间段，它票房就特别好，所以其他的制片人就开始进来。 片子多了就装不下了，就把它变成了从12月1号开始，到这个春节前，都这2个月的时间都算成贺岁档了，而且呢，也不仅仅是喜剧了，就在这个时间段里，任何类型，只要好看，它票房都非常好。He
said, intentionally in the very beginning, it was only from Christmas until January 1st, basically, the calendar new year.
Mm-hmm.
And then it has to be comedy to be called a Hesuipion. But because everyone sees it's the biggest market in the entire year, and more producers want to have their film out at this time, there's just too many.
Yes.
So you have to kind of just extend it. So he said now it's between December 1st until the Lunar New Year, and it doesn't strictly have to be comedy. So, that period of time.
Well, I know that the Hesuipion films that you made, and then also just almost all of the films that you made have some kind of a comment about society, whether it's the prevalence of cell phones or advertising or other things. And I just wonder, do you feel that the best way to get people to look at themselves and their world around them is through entertainment, and you know, to get them to think about that? Is that the power of the movies?
Mm.
他说就是您虽然都是喜剧，但是喜剧里面会有很多对于这个社会的想法，反映这个社会就是这个年代的事情，比如说像手机，就是这个个人私隐的问题，包括这个广告。他说您会不会觉得就是通过大众娱乐来让人反省自己是一个比较好的途径？你说的非常对，那个，就是其实我 从一开始拍的那些喜剧都有非常明显的我自己的个人的风格在里边，也不是一个纯粹的商业片。我还是希望里边对新的改革开放的中国的那种人物关系和他们的那个生活的状态，这些都是过去中国电影没有的表现的。我就开始，所以你按照我的那个电影的序列，这十几年的电影过来，你 观众可以通过这些看到这个新的这个中国商业的这种走市场的中国这些年的变化，一步一步的怎么变过来。
He said, if you look at his films from beginning until as of now, you can really see the transformation of China, basically. He implanted little bits and pieces of the like economic changes, ideology-wise, and then it's all in there. So he's really interested in just to capture the change of China and then how that affects people and their relationship between each other.
With Assembly, with Aftershock, and now with Back to 1942, you have now gone back and looked at some of some of the history of China as opposed to just the present day. Mm-hmm. And I wonder, you know, prior to that, many people had just sort of had labeled you as a comedy director, but clearly with these three films, which were all very well received, did quite well commercially, in some cases historically well commercially, what led you to your desire to explore sort of dramatic historical topics?
Mm. 他说就像您说的在拍 集结号之前，但您大概都是讲中国的变化呀，都是当代的事情。说怎么就突然从那个集结号，然后1942还有这唐山大地震，您开始往回看，就是在中国历史上比较有历史的这一段时间。在他说的这几部电影之前，我们的主要任务就是把市场做热。
把这个市场做热之后，有那个能力来这个市场来消化这种大制作电影的这个投资的时候，我开始要拍一些就是我觉得对我们自己这个民族的一个认识和反省的影片。
He said, he felt like before with the genre Hosepian is more like warming up the market. He felt obligated to bring back the market. Mm-hmm. But then after that, as you said, like for like assembly after Shock 1942, he felt like, okay, now the audience is ready to take on something that's more serious and something that reflects our culture. And then, yeah.
所以那个 我有一个特点，就是当大家都在陶醉的拍艺术片的时候，我去拍了那个商业电影。后来，当所有的导演又全部都跳到这个商业电影里头来的时候，我又很奇怪的去拍了很多偏文艺的电影。He
said, he just made that choice because when everyone wanted to be artsy. He was making commercial films, but now since the commercial market, it's so great in China, everyone's doing that, but he felt like, maybe not, I want to go back to art. Yeah.
And it must be very gratifying, though, to see a movie like Aftershock make record amounts of money at the box office, because what it's showing is that that experiment worked, isn't it? That that audiences now were ready and interested in coming out and seeing a movie in large numbers about something that wasn't comedic at all.
他说像唐山大地震就非常有历史性，因为这是一个平时它虽然是商业片，但它的题材什么的不是常规的那种让大家很想去看的，但是也创造了这个中国历史票房的最高。这个
我觉得这个，我就是我的电影就是两类，一类是我自己的生活，我特别有感受的，记录我的成长，我的对社会的感受，生活的感受，这一类我觉得其实我觉得有点像乌迪艾伦的那种，就是他乌迪艾伦他都是写他自己最熟悉的东西。
He said he believes his film has two different types, and the first type is to capture his own life, to reflect upon his own life, and to show the audience what his understanding of the world of life is. He compares himself to like Woody Allen style. He's only, yeah.
那么这一类的电影大概都基本上是自己写剧本。
So this type of film, he usually writes of himself, writes the story.
另一类的电影是我认识的一些中国最好的几个作家的朋友，我是从他们的小说里来的，但是他们那些小说让我觉得都充满了对民族苦难的一种反思。我觉得就是这类电影，我也是觉得拍出来非常有意义。
He said the second type is he adapts from really famous novels and pieces from really famous writers in China. And those topics usually deals with the struggle, a lot about struggle, desperation of the culture and ideology. And he believes these kind of films have more meaning to it.
Mm-hmm.
中国的经济的发展给中国的老百姓造成了很多人觉得很盲目的一种自豪感。 好像觉得现在我们有钱了，很了不起了，经济发展了，所以其实大家就忘了我们实际上是一个特别灾难深重的一个民族，在整个世界的民族之林里头，可能中国中华民族承受的苦难是最重的、最深的，大家好像就忘了这些了，而且不愿意回头去看这些。
我觉得有必要用电影来提醒大家，我们这个民族其实才刚刚从那个深渊里往上爬。嗯嗯 ，He said because of the economy booming really really fast in China, a lot of people have become conceited in his eyes, and then they actually forget how much struggle the Chinese culture had before, and he felt like he should use film to remind them where they came from.
Well, back to 1942 certainly does that, and I guess I understand that you've spent 17 years trying to bring this story to the screen, and I just wonder, why did you feel so passionate about this particular story, and why did it take that many years to finally be able to get it made?
他说，1942肯定是达到了这个让人们反思以前的这个效果。他说，知道您用了17年才把这个电影真正搬上大荧幕，是为什么用了这么长时间？因为一开始这个电影，因为它是揭民族的伤疤嘛。所以表面上说它不是一个积极意义的电影。在17年前我想拍的时候，那时候是不能够审查通过。 在17年前我想拍的时候，那时候是不能够审查通过的。同时，也那个时候也因为拍这个电影要花很多的钱。那个时候也不可能有人投资拍这个电影。那随着后来，为什么能有机会拍这个电影？是因为第一，剧本可以通过了，经过我们的争取。第二个就是。 这个市场可以有这么大的投资，能够消化了，所以，还有一个重要的原因就是这么多年我拍了很多电影，票房都非常好，观众呢对我产生了一个极大的信任，基本上就是过去大家认为这种题材都不可能赚钱，不可能有观众的，我。 几部片子做了试验，全部都观众反应很强烈，所以我也可以利用观众的这个信任来拍我想拍的这个电影。
He said, first of all, back 17 years ago, it was really hard. It was almost impossible to get it past the censorship because that part of history is an open wound to a lot of Chinese people. So it's just a subject that you can't touch. And because the market, it's better, but it's not big enough to handle such a big production because it required a lot of money to make that film. But last year, he felt like, okay, first of all, after 17 years of work, he was able to get the story past the censorship. So that's the most important thing. And then the market is mature enough to have such a big production that maybe to actually gain revenue too, not to lose money from a subject like this. He felt like over the years he built up enough trust in the Chinese audience to experience a risky theme like this. Because usually people will think, okay, a story like this in the New York Times, maybe it's not the best film that you want to go to. But he believes that it's because the trust the audience have him is so many years. Okay, because this film is labeled with his name, it has a certain guarantee.
Yeah. 这个电影的观众啊，我觉得在中国做导演还是比较幸福的，因为在香港 比如说在世界上很多地方，包括在美国，其实观众首先要选择哪个明星演。
嗯嗯。
那么在中国呢是一个例外啊，很多的观众他首先要想这是哪个导演拍的，
嗯，
他们对导演的那种信任度是摆在第一位的。
嗯。I said, it's actually really lucky to be a Chinese director because, like, in Hollywood or even Hong Kong film market, it's really star-oriented. The audience choose whoever stars in the film and then watch it. But in China, it's very director-based, director-centered. So the audience actually pick, okay, this director is who I like. Maybe I'll go watch his film.
Speaking of stars, I know that on a few occasions previously with Happy Funeral, and now with 1942, you have elected to cast American or Hollywood actors in your films. Donald Sutherland with that, now Adrian Brody and Tim Robbins. What led to the decision to work with them, and what was it like working with them?
他说说起明星，他觉得您是比较早开始接触好莱坞演员的中国导演，就从大腕开始，然后这次1942有 Adrian 跟 Tim， 就是您怎么会想到用好莱坞演员，然后跟他们合作，有什么感想？
第一个我觉得是剧情的需要，然后呢第二个我觉得我比如说 Donald Sutherland， 还有Tim Robbins and 这个 Adrian Brody， 我通过跟他们的合作，我觉得美国的这些明星都非常的有演技，非常的专业。他们，你跟他们合作的时候，我发现他们对人物的理解都非常的准确。对这个影片的帮助是非常大的。我说的还不是票房上的帮助。
You feel like, first of all, those the three actors you mentioned, they were perfect for the story, for the part. And working with them, you feel like American, these three actors in particular, he felt they're really professional and they are really, really good actors. Their understanding to the role is very, very accurate. And then he feels like they were able to give so much to the film, not box office wise.
你比如说 Adrian Brody， 他跟我说，他说他为什么接这个电影，他看了这个剧本之后，他妈妈也看了这剧本，他妈妈说你一定要演这个电影，他说他妈妈说因为我原来就是一个匈牙利的难民，我从匈牙利逃亡出来辗转到了美国纽约，你就是一个难民的后代，现在是拍一个中国的难民，所以他跟你是有关系的。
He said, Adrian, for example, after Adrian read the script, his mom read it as well. And then his mom is actually a refugee from Hungary. And then they moved to New York. Adrian's mom told him, well, this story is very much related to you. Like everyone in China, you're also a descendant of the refugees.
Right.
而且他妈妈说，他好像就是被1942年生的这么一个演员，他演那个钢琴课啊，波兰斯基
那个也是
在42年那时候的，他有那个时候的那个气质，好像也和1942年有一种缘分。
Adrian's mom said, it's so funny. It's almost like she gave birth to Adrian, so because he can play really good roles that's related to the year 1942, like the piano as well.
This is the second time after Aftershock, I believe. 1942 is the second time that China has submitted your film for the Oscar for foreign language film. That must be a pretty exciting thing.
他说那个继唐山大地震之后，这是中国第二次选您的影片作为奥斯卡最佳外语片，这个还是很让您高兴的事儿吧。
对，我觉得这部1942其实就我认为它就比较接近于这个奥斯卡了。原来有些电影因为我们有很多审查的原因，我们总是有一些东西可能 在美国人看来还是有一些意识形态的东西他们不容易接受，
嗯，
但是1942这部电影我觉得它没有什么这方面，
嗯，
它就是讲人性，
嗯，
讲苦难，我觉得是一个全世界的观众都可以理解的。
嗯，he believes that for 1942 is the closest you can get to an Oscar level film for China because of the censorship. Before that, all the films that have been submitted, maybe American audience feel like there's still a barrier between like the ideology. They can't really agree to a lot of things that they see. But this film is really different because he feels the pain and the struggle, which are the themes of the film.It's very, it's international. It's not about China alone.
嗯，很多导演呢，都，当然都奥斯卡的影响力在那儿哈，都当然都希望能够在奥斯卡这儿有收获。
嗯，
所以有的时候他们也在猜奥斯卡会评委们喜欢什么样的电影。
嗯，
我觉得这种做法肯定是不行的。
嗯，
因为你拍电影，他可能这一届给了这个电影。
嗯，
大家说哦，这样的题材可以得奥斯卡奖，
嗯，
大家就按照这个去拍，
嗯，
他就其实他已经给了这样的电影了，下一次他一定是不同的方向，
嗯，
所以你就是拍你自己认为最感动你的故事就可以了，
嗯 ，and then he said a lot of Chinese directors, well, because the Academy Awards is such and high honor and other film festivals as well, a lot of directors make films to cater to the taste of the Academy or other film festivals. But he believes that's not right because, first of all, you can't predict what kind of films they like every year.
Mm-hmm.
And the second of all, he believes a good film only comes when you believe in it, when you really want to tell the story, but not to other people's needs. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
所以你不要去猜评委会喜欢什么，因为你永远你也猜不着。
So don't try to guess what they like, because they'll always surprise you.
你其实就是拍你自己觉得感动的、有价值的电影，你就会影响到他们。
So make a film that touches you, yourself,and then we'll touch other people as well.
May I just ask a few other quick ones and then I'll be done?
Of course.
Okay, thank you.
You
are frequently called, at least in America, the Chinese Spielberg. And I wonder how you feel about that. Is it something you like? Is it something you dislike? What are your thoughts?
他说至少在美国人眼里很多人管他们叫中国的斯皮尔伯格。您对这个头衔有什么看法？
我觉得这当然是这个我和斯皮尔伯格还差很远。当然我很欣赏他，为什么呢？就是他是让我觉得是可以信任的一个导演。
嗯，
就是经他的创作出来的电影，你觉得他有一个基本的水准，不会让你太失望。
嗯。He said, of course, it's an honor, but he's no Spielberg. There's still a long way to go for him. But it is, Spielberg is someone Mr. Feng really admired, mm-hmm. because he's one of those directors who has a certain guarantee his film cannot be too bad. Yeah.
我觉得包括马丁·希克塞斯，
嗯，
美国有这么几个导演，
嗯，
他就是给了我们一个安全感，对观众来说，觉得他。这个东西出来不会太差。
Like Martin Scorsese too, he believes there are a few directors in America who has a certain standard whenever they make a film. So it just can't be disappointing.、Mm-hmm. Yeah.
就是他们的电影都是既有艺术性，同时也讲把故事讲得非常好，就是观众看起来也没有障碍，
Feel like those directors are able to, first of all, their films still have very high artistic value, but then at the same time, the audience is really able to actually understand the film and enjoy the story.
How do you see the Chinese cinema dealing with some of the challenges that it faces? For instance, piracy still remains a big issue, I know.
Mm-hmm.
And that must be very frustrating as a filmmaker.
Mm-hmm.
The fact that Chinese films still struggle to find an audience abroad, in many cases, are these things that are frustrating to you as a as a filmmaker, and do you think there are things that are going to change anytime soon?
他说有几件事是让中国导演比较头疼的。他说有一件比较大的就是这个盗版的问题，然后还有一件呢就是虽然中国电影一直受欢迎，但是对海外市场来说其实还没有那么的普及。这对您来说这两个问题是问题吗？或者您有什么看法？
是两个很重要的问题。
嗯，
一个是就是这个盗版的这个事儿对我们的这个行业的伤害非常大。
嗯，
但是很多观众就是他有两个原因看盗版。
嗯嗯，
一个原因就是他能够在最快的时间看到在国内看不到的那些世界上的比较出色的电影。
嗯，
还有一个原因就是人性的弱点嘛，他就是看这很便宜。
嗯，
啊，他跟电影票比起来的，
嗯，
他可能是只要花一点的钱就可以。
嗯，
啊，这是导致这盗版严重的情况。
嗯，
但是近年来，我认为呢，嗯，政府打击盗版的力度在增加。
嗯，
这个情况好了一点。
嗯。So, first of all, about pirate, first of all, he agrees with you. Those two are really big problems that the Chinese directors are facing nowadays. And then for piracy, it's definitely hurting the industry a lot. And he believes that people watch pirated film for two reasons. First of all, it's the fastest way to get access to a film, because a lot of the foreign films are not released in China,
mm-hmm.
but you can buy it on DVD.
Mm-hmm.
And then the second one is that it's a weakness to everyone. It's cheap.
Mm-hmm.
It's a lot cheaper than going to a theater.
Mm-hmm.
So, but he believes, well, the government is doing better at helping the directors and just really crushing the piracy industry.
Mm-hmm.
They are trying. So it is improving.
Yes.
还有一个原因，好一些的原因是，很多年轻的观众他认为看电影是一个时尚，现在，
嗯，
所以即便是有盗版，他们还是也希望到电影院去看。
嗯 ，that other from the government's effort, also a lot of young people believes right now, well, going to the movies it's trendy, not to buy pirated DVDs.Shows that they're better,
mm-hmm.
so they actually feel like okay, I'm doing something that's it's both good for myself and good for the industry by going to the films.、Mm-hmm. Yeah.
关于中国的电影在海外的成绩并不是太好，
mm-hmm.
观众不是特别多的，我觉得这个也有两个原因。
Mm-hmm.
嗯，一个原因呢，我觉得其实还是你本身电影拍的不够。普世价值观，
嗯，
啊，就是创作上的原因，
嗯，
另外一个原因就是，其实非英语语种的电影，
嗯，
都差不多这情况，
嗯，
啊，你说德国的，西班牙的、法国的，
嗯，
日本的、韩国的电影，
嗯，
其实都在海外的表现不是太好。
嗯，
这个和语言有关系，因为主流市场还是看英语电影。
嗯。He believes the second question about Chinese films not being too widely received in foreign markets. He believes there are two reasons too. Well, first of all, it's simple. It's just the movie we made. It's still not easy enough for everyone to relate to, and that's why they can't really enjoy it because there's no connection between.And then, second of all, he believes it's all foreign films that's struggling from this, foreign language films. So same for European, Japanese, other Asian films as well. It's, the language barrier is another thing that's hard to overcome.
那么美国的那个，他们这个，八大公司的这些，有时候我跟他们的老板接触，他们说了一个道理，我就说了一个原因，我觉得有道理。他说在美国。有很大的市场，
嗯，
很多的观众，但是他们已经长期美国观众习惯了不看有字幕的电影，
嗯，
如果是有字幕的电影，你即便拍的是商业电影，
嗯，
在美国观众看来你也是一个文艺片， 啊，他就是看文艺片、看字幕电影的观众是小众的，不是大众的。
嗯，
你中国电影到这儿来，你还是有字幕的电影。
嗯，
所以他的观众不会特别多。
嗯 ，He said he actually had this really interesting conversation with a lot of like one of this the 8 big film studio companies in America about、
mm-hmm.
the foreign film issue, the foreign language film issue,、
mm-hmm.
and then the directors and the people he talked to said that American audiences are actually trained to watch films without subtitles in theaters.、
Mm-hmm.
So there's an instant relation that people make once you see a film with subtitles, you feel like, okay, this is an art film.、
Mm-hmm.
This is not a commercial film. So there's, it's always, he said, it's always a niche market who's willing to watch a film with subtitles.
That's true, and very few exceptions aside from like Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon.
Mm, that's true.
That's the only one that I can think of that's really done very well in this country.
Mm,
mm.
另外呢，一个导演进入到一个他陌生的市场，不是本土的以外的市场去的时候、
嗯，
其实他不可能是几年就能成功的。
嗯，
他其实需要几十年的这个不断的渗透、
嗯、
影响。使那个观众越来越了解他，越来越了解他、
嗯、
同时他要配合强大的宣传的攻势、
嗯、
可是一个对这个市场比较陌生的一个导演、
嗯、
在进入这个市场的时候
嗯,
嗯，不太会有公司去投入很大的宣传费去推广这个导演的、
嗯、
所以他就需要时间的累积
嗯, 嗯 He said for a foreign actor to go into foreign territory is always really hard because first of all, you really need a long period of time and a lot of work to actually get soaked into the market so the audience can really remember you and your works. And at the same time, there needs to be a lot of money spent on marketing and advertising. Yeah, and it's really rare for... It's really rare for a production company to invest in such a massive way for a foreign director. So mainly, he said, it's, you just need a really long period of time、
mm-hmm.
yeah, to get recognized in a foreign territory.
所以你看，比如说我的电影刚开始去香港和去韩国的市场的时候，观众完全不了解，他也不会想来看。但是因为这十几年下来，你比如说香港和韩国的观众就开始对我有了解了，他觉得哎，有就开始已经有我的观众群了。
嗯、he said just like when he first started in Hong Kong and Korea in like Asian territories, they didn't recognize him as well. Like they don't know who he is. But it's because it's been over 10 years now.、
Mm-hmm.
He's already has a fan base in those countries as well. It's because that long period of time.
Yeah.
And the exposure is over and over, and that、
mm-hmm.
helps.
Last two questions, I promise. I hope this is a okay question to ask you about, and if not, just let me know. But、
mm-hmm.
If the first two frustrating things for Chinese filmmakers were piracy and you know, getting films seen abroad,、
mm-hmm.
I think the one that my sense is would be the most frustrating thing would be the censorship, which you've talked a little bit about.、
Mm-hmm.
And in April...when you were honored at the Film Directors Guild in Beijing,、
oh.
you gave a very emotional speech、at which you spoke about this, and which was then censored. and I wonder what led you to talk about the subject there, what sort of a reaction did the remarks receive,、
mm-hmm.
and do you feel that censorship has gotten any better over the time that you have been making films in China?
他说如果盗版跟这个在海外能得到认知是两个中国导演比较头疼的，是中国导演最头疼的应该还是审查制度。他说他知道那个您今年四月份的时候在电影协会的那个发言上说了这个问题，说了审查的问题，但是这个又被屏蔽了，好多人也不知道您是这么说的。您觉得这么多年审查有没有就是对您来说有什么影响？然后
对，就是
变化，
我觉得每一次审查其实都会对这个电影有不同程度的损害，
嗯，
就是其实你可以更好，但是因为你要适应这审查，能让它 能够通过能够上映、
嗯、
你都要做一些妥协、
嗯、
这每一个妥协其实都是对你这个本身影片的一个伤害、
嗯、
这个是这么多年过来其实一直是这样，然后可能有一些进步，但是那个进步的脚步太慢了。
嗯 ，He said, "Well, the censorship bureau hasn't really been improving. It has making baby steps, but not big enough, so it's not a headache to all the directors." He said, "There's always little. You have to keep a lot of things in mind when you're making a film, and that's hurting the film already in the first place because you're always thinking, okay, can this get through?" And then after you send it to them, they give you a lot of little notes that you have to make changes to. And then that every little bit of sacrifice, in the end, it's a great harm to the film itself.
Mm-hmm. 有时候很多那个提的那个修改意见让你哭笑不得，你完全不能理解为什么这句台词怎么会有什么问题。
Mm-hmm. He said a lot of the suggestions that they give you, it's...Like, he always wants to laugh, too. Like, what does that even mean? Like, it's ridiculous to them. Like, what is wrong with this line? What is wrong with this shot? But they just make you change it.
所以有时候经常会很生气，觉得哎呀，真是不想再拍。
Yeah, so that's really frustrating to a lot of directors. And it almost feel like, okay, I just don't want to do this anymore because they're always there to stop me. Yeah.
但是拍电影很像是吸毒。它让你很上瘾，虽然有这么多困难，但是你可能会说气话不拍了，但是可能你过一年你还是有想拍的东西，你最后还是又去拍去。
Mm. He feels like making movies is almost like a drug. It's really addictive. Even though there's so many obstacles you have to overcome, but okay, you take a break. You say a lot of things that you don't mean. Like, I don't want to do this anymore, but...Then in the end, when you just have a couple of days to cool off, you still want to make movies.
And what was the response in China to that speech when he finally, you know, when he was able、mm-hmm. to address it in April? What did he get a lot of support, a lot of、mm-hmm. positive feedback,、mm-hmm. or did he get people giving him a hard time?
Yeah, 他说您在电影学会说了那个话以后、
mm-hmm.
观众就是大家的反应是什么样？大家都是支持您啊，还是说您为了那个还受到了小麻烦吗？
当然肯定在导演协会来讲场下的观众都是鼓掌的。
嗯、mm. ,of course within the guild everyone was like, yeah!
他们觉得终于有人就这样在一个公开的场合这样。
Finally someone can speak up about this in public.
那么电影审查的那些人呢他们就假装没有听见。
The people in the censorship bureau, they just pretend it never happened. Yeah.
And does...I know this is a extra, I'm sorry, one I have to ask, but do you have any real belief that this will change within your career, within the time that you're making films in China, that you will one day be able to make a film without censors having a say in it?
他说您觉得在您的就这个未来的从业这段时间内，您觉得有可能这个审查制度会不再干扰您吗？就没有？
我看不到可能性。
Doesn't seem possible.
and finally, last question. what does it mean to you to be invited to come here and immortalize your handprints and your footprints and everything at the Chinese Theater on Friday? Only one other Chinese person.John Woo has ever received this honor. Is it something that means a lot to you or that you can enjoy?
他说这个中文您要印那个手印跟脚印嘛，说在那块地上还有只有一个中国人，那就是吴宇森导演也有过，对您来说是个什么样的意义？
我当然觉得这个是一个荣誉哈。
嗯嗯，
然后我觉得可能也有一个商业的考虑，就是现在中国的游客越来越多，
嗯嗯，
他们可能很想在那个中国剧院门口能找到他们认识的导演。
He said, "Of course, it's a huge honor for him to have his prints." right there. He said it's all maybe it's for tourism as well. There's a lot of Chinese tourists every day, and maybe they want to find someone who they actually know when they're taking pictures, and that would be nice too.
所以我对这个事儿的认识没有那么，我还是比较实际，没有那么膨胀。
就是我觉得中国可能有很多导演和明星其实都比我更有资格来演这个，但是可能就是，当然我可能是因为是观众最喜欢的导演之一，所以可能他们选择我也是为了吸引更多的游客，而不是说因为我的电影是最厉害的。 He said they chose him to do it. Maybe it's not because he's the most popular filmmaker in China. He believes there's more, a lot of movie stars and directors who's also, they also deserve to leave their prints here. But he is really popular, and a lot of people like him. Everyone likes him in China. So yeah, it's nice to have him there.
Well, I can't thank you enough. It's an honor, and I really appreciate you taking the time to do this.
谢谢您的时间，谢谢你的问题，我觉得你的问题让我觉得回答起来很轻松。
He
said your questions were really well organized, and it's really easy to talk to you.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
No problem. Thank you, Scott.